وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله الذي شرح صدور أوليائه بالإيمان وفتح لهم أبواب النصوص بقواعد البيان، وصلى الله وسلم على من أنزل الله عليه الكتاب والميزان وعلى آله وصحابته ومن تبعهم بإحسان، أما بعد. قال المصنف رحمه الله، the author رحمه الله، he said النهي تعريفه. النهي قول يتضمن طلب الكف على وجه الاستعلاء بصيغة مخصوصة هي المضارع المقرون بلا الناهية، مثل قوله تعالى ولا تتبع أهواء الذين كذبوا بآياتنا والذين لا يؤمنون بالآخرة. ولا تتبع أهواء الذين كذبوا بآياتنا والذين لا يؤمنون بالآخرة. فخرج بقولنا قول الإشارة فلا تسمى نهيا وإن أفادت معناه. وخرج بقولنا طلب الكف الأمر لأنه طلب فعل. وخرج بقولنا على وجه الاستعلاء الالتماس والدعاء وغيرهما مما يستفاد من النهي بالقرائن. وخرج بقولنا بصيغة مخصوصة هي المضارع إلى آخره، ما دل على طلب الكف بصيغة الأمر مثل دع، اترك، كف ونحوها. فإن هذه وإن تضمنت طلب الكف لكنها بصيغة الأمر فتكون أمرا لا نهيا. وقد يستفاد طلب الكف بغير صيغة النهي، مثل أن توصف الفعل بالتحريم أو الحذر أو القبح، أو يذم فاعله، أو يرتب على فعله عقاب أو نحو ذلك.
The prohibition and nahi. The definition of prohibition is a statement which includes a request to avoid doing something that is from a high authority with a specific format, that of the present tense coupled with the lam of prohibition, such as the statement of the Most High, do not follow those who deny our revelations and who do not believe in the hereafter. What is excluded from our definition is the word gestures, as it is not known as a prohibition even if it gives it a meaning. And what is also excluded from our words, a request to avoid something, is a command because it is a request to do something. And what is also excluded from our words, from a higher authority, is an appeal, a supplication, or other than that from which a prohibition can be deduced. And what is also excluded from our words, a specific format of the present tense, etc., is what indicates a request to abstain from something with the format of al-amr, command, like da', leave alone, utruk, leave abandon, kaf, leave off, and the like, even though this includes a request to stop. But the form is for a command and not a prohibition. Furthermore, the prohibition can be understood in ways other than the normal forms of prohibition as mentioned above, such as when the act is described as haram, severely warned against, distasteful, the perpetrator is disparaged, or that a punishment is ascribed to it, and so on.
The author, rahimahullah, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih Uthaymeen, when he clarified al-amru, the command, he went into the opposite of the command, which is an-nahyu, prohibition. The reason is because the usuliyin, the scholars of usulul fiqh, they say, kullu mas'ala في الأمر لها وزان في النهي. The أصوليين, the scholars of أصول الفقه, they say كل مسألة, every issue في الأمر, which is in the command, لها وزان في النهي, it has an opposition, it has an opposing spectrum, which is prohibition. The author, rahimahullah, he didn't define what نهي means in the Arabic language. He only defined it according to the Usuliyin, Istilah al-Usuliyin. The author only mentioned that. But what nahyu means in the Arabic language is al-zajr wal-man'u. It is to prevent and stop something. وَلِهَذَا And because of that, al-aqlu, the intellect in the Arabic language is called nuhya. The aql is called nuhya. And the plural of nuhya is what? Nuha. Doesn't Allah not say ulu nuha, the people of intellect? وَلِذَلِكَ The Prophet said in the hadith, فَلِيَلِنِي Let it come close to me in the prayer. In the first line, who? The people who are ulu nuha. لِيَلِنِي مِنْكُمْ أَهْلُ النُّهَى The Prophet ﷺ, he said, let the people of the Qur'an and the people who are intellectual and smart, let them come closest to me. Why is the aql referred to as nuhyatan? The reason is because it prevents the individual from doing مِمَّا لَا يَلِيقُ that which does not befit him. The smart individual does not do what is not befitting. He doesn't do inappropriate things. That's why the word aql is called nuhya. That's the linguistic usage or the lexical usage. Now we're going to go into the technical usage that the author gave, rahimahullah. He said that the definition of an-nahyu, prohibition, is according to the usuliyin, qawlun, a speech. When we say qawl, again, qawl is a jins. Under it falls five things. What falls under it? Five things. What are the five things? Number one, an-nahy. Prohibition is a speech. Wal-taqyir, giving a person an option. Wal-amr, commanding. Wal-du'a, supplication. And the fifth one is al-iltimas, appealing. To appeal to someone. Those five are qawlun, they fall under speech. And then, at the first statement of qawlun, the author hasn't still taken out the rest. He has not got rid of the rest from the definition. He only got rid of al-ishara and al-fi'l. Actions are not considered prohibitions. And then you can't, if you say this to a person, and you place your finger on your lips, and you say, be quiet, or you tell a person, don't do something, or you say that to them, all of that is not considered a nahi. Even if it benefits prohibition. Which is what? Al-zajr wal-man'u. It gives you the meaning of preventing you from something, stopping you from something. It's still not nahi according to the usuliyin. Because it has to be what? Qawlun. Then the author said, talabun, request. It's qawlun yatadammanu talab. It's a speech that consists of what? Requesting. And then when you say the word talab, request, what is it that leaves the definition now? We got rid of at-takhir, option. Given the person option. From the five, which one is gone now? At-takhir, to give a person an option. Because that's not a talab. That is not a talab. So it doesn't enter fi haqiqati an-nahy. It doesn't go into the definition of an-nahy. Then the author said, talab al-kaf. Kaf means what? To stay away from. So what is it that leaves this? Al-amr. Al-amr, command. The command is a what? The command is, qawlun yatadammanu talab al-fi'l. Remember we took that when we were speaking about it in our last lesson. That amr is that you're being requested to do something. Nahi, you're requested to leave of something. Then al-kaf, when we say that, yahtarizu bihi anil amr. The author is trying to avoid letting amr come into the definition. Ala wajhi al-isti'la. Ala wajhi al-isti'la means in an authoritative manner. Remember we spoke about ala wajhi al-isti'la, the difference between al-isti'la and ulu. We spoke about it in the chapter of al-amr, in the chapter of command. So anyone who wants to know can go back there, inshallah ta'ala. But here the author wants to get rid of what? He wants to get rid of the last two remaining, which are what? Ad-du'a and al-iltimas. Supplication and appealing. They leave because they both don't come from an authoritative approach. The individual who's supplicating is not higher than the one who is supplicating to. Appealing comes from a lower person to a higher person. So that's good. Then the author said, بِصِيغَةٍ مَخْصُوصَةٍ بِصِيغَةٍ مَخْصُوصَةٍ in a specific format. Why did he say in a specific format? Why does the request of leaving something have to be done in a specific format? Why? Because the nahi, the prohibition, doesn't have any direct form. Sira, sariha, a direct form other than la taf'al. That's the only specific format it comes in. Such as the example that the author gave, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا هَوَاءَ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا وَالَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ. And another ayah would be an evidence for him, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Do not eat from the wealth of the orphans except with good. And also the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, لَا تَشْرَبُوا فِي آنِيَةِ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ. Do not drink from the vessels of gold, I mean, do not drink with gold and silver. So prohibition doesn't have a form other than that. لا تفعل. The reason why the author chose to say بصيغة مخصوصة is because he only wants it to be that specific format. He wants to leave the other form, which is افعل, do, but it benefits prohibition. Like when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Mughira, da'huma, leave it. فَإِنِّي أَدْخَلْتُهُمَا طَاهِرَتَيْنِ. Leave it. Leave it. I have what? I put them on when I was pure. I put it on in a state of purity. Don't take them off my khufayn. Don't take it off from me. فَإِنِّي أَدْخَلْتُهُمَا. I wore them طَاهِرَتَيْنِ in a state of tahara. da'huma, leave them. Is a what? If'al. But it's a what? It's a prohibition. He's prohibiting him from taking off his khufayn off him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also the ayah, وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever he prohibits from you, what? فَانْتَهُ. فَانْتَهُ is if'al. But it's a prohibition. These forms, it's not what the author wants. Why? Because it's a amar, it's not a nahi. Okay, these forms are called amar, we spoke about it before. Good. Also the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is another example, which is utruku al-habashata. Leave off the Abyssinians, leave them. Leave the Abyssinians. Ma tarakukum, as long as they leave you. The Prophet ﷺ, he prohibited for the Muslims to invade the Abyssinians. Jihad al-Talab is not done with the Abyssinians. The Muslims should not invade them to do Jihad al-Talab. The Abyssinians only Jihad al-Daf'i. If they wage war on you, then you should fight back with them. What is the reason why the Prophet said that? The reason why the Prophet said that, alayhi salatu wasalam, which is utruku al-habashata, leave the Abyssinians alone. Ma tarakukum, as long as they leave you. Because if they don't leave you alone and they want to fight with you, then you have to defend yourselves, your honor. You have to, but don't wage war on them. Why? فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَسْتَخْرِجُ كَنْزَ الْكَعْبَةِ إِلَّا ذُو سُوَيْقَتَيْنِ مِنَ الْحَبَشَةِ. Because there's no one else that's going to take the treasures from the Kaaba إِلَّا ذُو سُوَيْقَتَيْنِ مِنَ الْحَبَشَةِ. Except a man with small shins from Abyssinia will do that. Meaning the Prophet ﷺ is trying to allude to that these people are never going to accept any da'wah from Islam. If you fight with them, they won't take Islam. Because the concept of fighting with them in the first place was to bring them to Islam. But here, they won't accept it. They won't accept it. So it is not permissible to what? It is not permissible to fight with them. Also the Prophet ﷺ, he said in the hadith, اِجْتَنِبُ السَّبْعَ الْمُبِقَاتِ. Stay away from the seven destructive sins. Ijtanibu. All of these are not prohibitions. Because they all come in the form of what? If'al. And what was the only form that we said that is for prohibition? La taf'al. Which is a fi'il mudari' with a la an-nahiyah. Only that. Also, the Shaykh rahimahullah, he mentioned sighatun nahi, which is ghayru sariha, an indirect form of prohibitions. The Shaykh mentioned them rahimahullah ta'ala. And you can find them more in Kitab al-Muwafaqat, the third volume. We're going to mention the six that the author rahimahullah mentioned. Or the Shaykh mentioned five, and we're going to add the sixth one on there, inshaAllah ta'ala. The first one is أن يوصف الفعل بالتحريم. The action is described to be haram. Okay? أن يوصف الفعل. The action will be said about it that is haram. Like Allah said in the ayah, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ. The corpse are made haram from you. حُرِّمَتْ. The word haram has been used here. حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ. The corpse are haram from you. وَالدَّمُ. The blood. وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ. And the flesh of the swine. The second one is أَنْ يُوصَفَ بِالْحَذْرِ. بِالْحَذْرِ. That the word prohibition is used. And the word prohibition, حَذْرِ and تَحْرِيم is roughly the same. The third one is أَنْ يُوصَفَ بِالْقُبْحِ. That it's referred to as قُبْح. قُبْح here means what? Something that's filthy. Like the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, found in Sahih Muslim, ثَمَنُ الْكَلْبِ. The money that's attained from what? The dog is khabith. It's khabith, it's filthy, right? If you look at the word khabith, if you look at the usage of the word khabith, it's used in two meanings in the Quran, no other meaning. Wherever you find the word khabith in the Quran, it's one of two. It's either used as haram, the word khabith, number one, is either used as haram, as Allah said in the ayah, وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. Khabaith here means haram. He makes haram from them that things which are haram. The second one is radi, something that is what? Radi, something which is filthy. And that is the ayah, وَلَا تَيَمَّمُ الْخَبِيثَ مِنْهُ تُنْفِقُونَ. وَلَا تَيَمَّمُ الْخَبِيثَ. Do not give out the khabith, the filthy things, as sadaqah. Don't give it out as sadaqah. As Allah said, وَلَا تَيَمَّمُ الْخَبِيثَ مِنْهُ تُنْفِقُونَ. Don't give out and go towards the filthy things and give it out as charity. What you should give out in charity are the good things. And then the word khabith is used as either haram or radi, something which is filthy. Here, thamanu al-kalbi, khabith is haram. That the money that's made out of the dog is haram. You can't buy and sell dogs. And this mas'ala, we expanded on it more in our lecture, Prohibited Elements of Islamic Finance, in Islamic Finance. The fourth is, the fourth type of the indirect prohibition is أَنْ يُذَمَّ فَاعِلُهُ. The one who does it is rebuked, scolded. And this is like the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the woman who says that my husband gave me something when he didn't really give her something. She wants to go to her co-wives. A man is married to multiple wives. So she wants to go to her co-wives. And so what does she do? When she goes to her co-wives, she says to him, Allah, my husband, may Allah grant him Jannatul Firdaus. May Allah honor him. He does this for me. All this gold that I'm wearing, he bought it for me. But she's lying. She rented it from somewhere. She hired it from somewhere. She just wants to make her co-wife jealous. You see, this, the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? He said, Al-Mutashabbi'u بِمَا لَمْ يُعْطَى كَلَابِسِ ثَوْبَيِ الزُّورِ. The one who tries to pretend to be in a particular situation, to be like something, to claim something in which he wasn't given. بِمَا لَمْ يُعْطَى, that which he wasn't given. كَلَابِسِ, he's like a person who's wearing ثَوْبَيِ الزُّورِ, two garments, the upper and the lower garments of falsehood. It's like he's wearing two garments of falsehood. Meaning he's pretending to be what he really isn't. So this one, the one he's been scolded here, he's been rebuked, he's blamed. The fifth one is أَيُرَتَّبَ عَلَى فِعْلِ عِقَابٌ. His action, a punishment, it results to a punishment. His action will result to a punishment. كَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى, like the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَى ظُلْمًا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا. The ones who are eating the wealth of the orphans out of oppression, wrongly they are eating the wealth of the orphans. Allah said, إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ, they are eating nothing except فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا, they are placing in their stomach the hellfire. The hellfire. So this action is resulting and it's the outcome of a punishment, which is the hellfire being placed in their stomach. Number six is أَنْ يُلْعَنَ فَاعِلُهُ, the one who does it is cast. اللعن, what does it mean? الطَّرْدُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ, Allah's mercy is distance from them. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in a famous hadith, Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi narrated, and Imam Tirmidhi, he authenticated it in his Sunan, that the messenger, he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الرَّاشِيَ وَالْمُرْتَشِي, may Allah's curse be upon the one who takes bribery and the one who gives bribery. The one who takes and the one who gives it. Now some people, they haven't understood the reality of bribery and what does bribery actually mean. We have to define what bribery means. The scholars, they say bribery means مَا يُعْطَى, it is anything which is given لِإِبْطَالِ حَقٍ أَوْ إِحْقَاقِ بَاطِلٍ. مَا يُعْطَى, it is anything that is given لِإِبْطَالِ حَقٍ, لِإِبْطَالِ حَقٍ, to nullify the truth, to dismiss the truth, to avoid the truth. أَوْ إِحْقَاقِ بَاطِلٍ, or to establish falsehood, to push forward falsehood. That's what it means, the definition of bribery in our religion. For instance, a person is ما يعطى لإبطال حق, a person's rights is being destroyed. And the person, what does he do? إبطال حق, he wants to destroy and he wants to dismiss, sorry, the truth. A person wants to destroy the truth. So what does he do? He goes to the Qadi and he gives him money. And he says, get me out of this problem. Get me out of this problem. The second one is إِحْقَاقِ بَاطِلٍ. The second one is, he goes to the Qadi and he says, Qadi, this really isn't mine. This isn't really mine. This land or this property, I don't own it. I'll give you money, just give it to me. This is bribery. But if a person gives money to attain their own rights back, they want to attain what was taken from them. Their rights was taken from them. There's no other way that they can attain it, they can get it. A group of people have taken it from them and they won't give it to them unless they pay. Or the Qadi won't give it to them unless he pays bribery. And it's his rights. He is not doing إبطال حق أو إحقاق باطل. He just wants what is his rights. The scholars like Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and Abu Sulaiman al-Khattabi and others, they say that this is not bribery. Rather, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, the Salaf and the Khalaf, this is what they said. From great scholars of the Salaf and great scholars of the Khalaf, this is an opinion they hold. There are other group of scholars that say you can't even pay it, you can't pay it then, but that's not a strong view. The view that's the strongest is, if it's your rights that was taken from you, and there is no other way to get it unless you pay bribery to get what is yours, you're allowed to do so. The author, rahimahullah, he then said, مَا تَقْتَضِيهِ صِيغَةُ النَّهِي. صيغة النهي عند الإطلاق تقتضي التحريم المنهي عنه. صيغة النهي عند الإطلاق تقتضي تحريم المنهي عنه وفساده. فمن الأدلة على أنها تقتضي التحريم قوله تعالى: وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. فالأمر بالانتهاء عما نهى عنه يقتضي وجوب الانتهاء، ومن لازم ذلك تحريم الفعل. ومن الأدلة على أنه يقتضي الفساد قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم: من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد، أي مردود، وما نهي عنه فليس عليه أمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيكون مردودا.
What the wording of prohibition necessitates. When left unrestricted, it necessitates complete prohibition of that which is being forbidden and its invalidity. From the evidences that demonstrate that this is the statement of the Most High, and whatsoever the Messenger gives you, then take it, and whatsoever he forbids you from, then abstain from it. So the command is to stop at what he forbade us from, which requires that we must abstain from it. So then it in turn becomes a prohibited act. From the evidences that show the invalidity of certain actions, is the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam: whoever does an action that is not in accordance with our affair, then it is rad, i.e. rejected, and whatever he forbade us from. So if the order of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not followed, then it will be rejected.
This mas'ala that the author now goes into is called dalalatun nahi al-mutlaq. What does the unrestricted prohibition indicate? That's what we're going to go into now. What does the unrestricted prohibition indicate? What does it indicate? And this is one of the most important chapters within al-nahi, because many issues of fiqh is connected to this. Many. And whatever position you take now on this issue will determine the outcome of many of your views. The prohibition is looked at from two angles, and the Shaykh rahimahullah mentioned it. The first one is the prohibition. What does it indicate in regards to what is being prohibited? For instance, if a prohibition comes in the Kitab of Allah Azza wa Jalla and the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what should we consider it? What should we believe of it? What should we hold regarding it? What should our view be regarding this prohibition? Is it haram or is it disliked? This is the question. But remember, the prohibition that we're talking about is the unrestricted prohibition. I mean, if it gets connected with an external evidence, then it becomes whatever that external evidence makes it become. For instance, Allah says in the ayah, وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَةَ. Do not conceal the testimony. So that's a prohibition, right? Now this prohibition is not an unrestricted prohibition. The reason why it's not an unrestricted prohibition is because Allah says, وَمَنْ يَكْتُمْهَا فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبَهُ أَمَّا فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُهُ. The Prophet Allah Azza wa Jalla here, he says, وَمَنْ يَكْتُمْهَا, whoever conceals it, فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ, he is a sinner, قَلْبُهُ, his heart. إِذَنْ فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُهُ. This has now become an external evidence that made it become haram. Remember we said the things that make something haram is what? أَيُّذَمَّ فَاعِلُهُ. The one that does it is rebuked. Or أَيُّرَتَّبَ عَلَى فِئْلِهِ عِقَابٍ. That his action, it results to a punishment. So in this situation, وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَ وَمَنْ يَكْتُمْهَا فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُهُ. It turned it away from the unrestricted prohibition. So this one, we know it's haram because of external evidence. We're not discussing this one. Also another example is وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا. Do not come close to zina. This is not an unrestricted prohibition, because came after it is إِنَّوْ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ السَّبِيلًا. It's a filthy thing, it's a crime, it's a sin, and what an evil way it is. So إِنَّوْ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ السَّبِيلًا is a قَرِينَة. It's an external evidence that indicates that it is what? Haram. That's not what we're talking about. For example, if another, so all the two examples I gave you is when there was an external evidence that made it haram. What about if another external evidence came and took the prohibition towards other than haram? For instance, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم's hadith, and then Nabiya صلى الله عليه وسلم زجر أن يقبر الرجل بالليل إلا أن يضطر الإنسان إلى ذلك. The hadith of Sahih Muslim, where it mentions that the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, hadith ibn Abbas in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet, he prohibited that an individual is buried at night unless there's a necessity for it. This prohibition, it doesn't show haram. The reason is because the Prophet ﷺ asked about a man, salawatullahi wa salamun alayhi, in the hadith of Abbas, what did he say? Marra biqabrin, the Prophet ﷺ went by a grave. Qad dufina laylan, the person was buried at night time. The Prophet then said, mata dufina hada, when was this man buried? When was this person buried? And then they said, dufina al-bariha, he was buried last night. Then the Messenger ﷺ said to the companions, why didn't you tell me? They said, O Messenger of Allah, we didn't want to wake you up. So we buried him and we prayed on him. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he stood up and he prayed on the man, and everyone lined up behind the Prophet ﷺ, and they prayed with him. And Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he said, I was from the people who prayed with the Prophet ﷺ. Here we take from it is that the Prophet did not reject, he did not scold them, he did not blame them. وَلَمْ يُنْكِرْ عَلَيْهِمْ دَفْنُهُ لَيْلًا. He did not tell them off for burying nighttime. So this prohibition, we see it's what? That it's not haram. Also, when the Prophet ﷺ, he spoke about eating in the utensils or the vessels of the non-Muslims, the Prophet said, لَا تَأْكُلُ فِيهَا, do not eat from it. إِلَّا أَلَّا تَجِدُ غَيْرَهَا فَغْسِلُوهَا وَكُلُوا مِنْهَا. Unless you can't find other than it, meaning don't eat from the cups and the plates of the non-Muslims, unless you can't find anything other than it, then wash their plates and their utensils properly and eat from it. لَا تَأْكُلُوا, the Prophet said, don't eat. This prohibition, it is not ليس للتحريم, it's not for haram. This prohibition doesn't show tahrim. It shows karaha to tanzih. And the evidence for that is he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a woman, she brought him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam food on a plate from the Ahlul Kitab. He also did wudu alayhi salatu wa sallam from their utensils and etc. So here what we say is, this is not what we're talking about. We're not talking about dalalatun nahi al-mutlaq, the unrestricted prohibition. We're talking about the restricted prohibition. We're talking about the unrestricted one. أكثر الأصوليين, the overwhelming majority of the أصوليين, including the author himself, Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, they hold the opinion that if the prohibition comes unrestricted, there's no external evidence that's taking it to any direction, they are of the opinion that it's على التحريمي, that it shows haram in its default position. And the evidence that they use are many. The author only used the most famous evidence that they all use, meaning those who are of his opinion. They all use this evidence, which is وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ, whatever the Prophet gives you. The word here that's being used in the ayah is وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ. And one has to know the difference between آتَاكُم and أَتَاكُم. آتَاكُم is a fi'l mutaaddi. Aataakum. And it takes maf'ulayni, two maf'uls. Aataakum. Whatever the messenger gives you, take it from him. Whereas, wama ataakum is a fi'l lazim, which means ja'a. So the first one is a transitive verb, and the second one is intransitive verb. And one has to know the difference between the two. Aataakum, it means a'ta. Whatever he gives to you, take from him. Aataakum. It means a'ta. And it takes two maf'uls because it's a transitive verb. It goes to two maf'uls, two objects. But when you say ataakum, it is a intransitive verb and it means ja'a. And that's the author, rahimahullah, ayah that he used. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُوذُوهُ. Whatever the Prophet gives to you, take it from him. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ. Whatever he prohibits from you, فَانْتَهُ. Stay away from it. What's the wajhul istidlan? How is he trying to extract from this ayah that the unrestricted prohibition, it shows at-tahrim, it shows haram. How is he trying to extract from it? The way that he's trying to extract from it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he commanded to leave off that which the Prophet ﷺ prohibited from us. And we already took before that the unrestricted command, it shows obligation. So from that, it necessitates doing that which is prohibited from you is muharram, it's haram. Because the prohibition is the opposite of the command. Because if a person does an action which is wajib, if doing an action is wajib, leaving it off is what? Leaving it off is haram. So from this, the result that comes from it is the nahi yaqtadi tahrim, it benefits what? Prohibition. So the qa'idah for them is anna nahi al mutlaq yaqtadi tahrim. The unrestricted prohibition benefits haram. And there are many furu' issues that come from this. Meaning this issue has a lot of fiqh issues stand on it. There is a lot of fiqh issues that stand on it, based on this. For example, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, صَلُّوا فِي مَرَابِضِ الْغَنَمِ Pray in the marabid al-ghanam. Marabid al-ghanam means what? It means pray in the rest place of the sheep. Pray in it if you want to. وَلَا تُصَلُّ فِي مَبَارِكِ الْإِبِلِ. Don't pray in the rest places of the camel. So this prohibition, does it show haram? It all depends on whether you take أن النهي المطلق يقتضي التحريم. Facing the Qibla when you're doing your call of nature, or facing away from it without any, of course, you're not inside a building or anything, you're outside. Can you face the Qibla whilst doing your call of nature, or can you face away? The Prophet said, لا تستقبلوا القبلة ولا تستدبروها بغائط ولا بول ولكن شرقوا أو غربوا. The hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. لا تستقبلوا القبلة ولا تستدبروها. Don't face the Qibla and don't face away from the Qibla. بغائط ولا بول ولكن شرقوا أو غربوا. So here the question is, the statement of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, لا تستقبلوا القبلة, don't face the Qibla. And don't turn your back towards the Qibla when you're doing your call of nature. Does it show haram? Does it show haram? All based upon, this all goes back to what? Dalalatun nahi al-mutlaq. What does the unprohibited prohibition benefit? Does it benefit at-tahrim? Or does it benefit otherwise? We spoke about that first part. We're now going to move on to the next part that the author rahimahullah mentioned regarding dalalatun nahi al-mutlaq, that which the unrestricted prohibits benefits us. What is it? Ala fasad al-manhi anhu. Does it show us the unrestricted prohibition? Does it also show us that the thing that the person did, the prohibition that he did, is now null and void? Does it destroy everything? Does it nullify everything? Does it terminate everything? The usuliyin again are unanimously in agreement. If there comes an external evidence that shows that it's terminated, that it's null and void, then of course it is. They agree on that. For example, the statement of the Prophet regarding a man who sold sa' min tamrin. He sold the sa' of a tamar. Sa' of a tamar. By the way, the measurement of the sa' is 2.600 kilograms. Because the sa' is 4 mud. And 1 mud is the cuff of a hand man like this. Okay? And the Hay'at Kibar al-Ulama, the measurement I'm giving you is the measurement of Hay'at Kibar al-Ulama. They said that 4 mud is what? Is 1 sa'. Sa'. It's 1 sa'. 4 mud is 1 sa'. 1 mud is the hand of an ordinary man. The measurement of that for them is 650. 650 grams. 650 grams times 4. It's what? 2.600 now. That's the kilograms. That's the measurement of a sa'. This man, the Prophet's speech here is fi bay'i sa'in. The selling of one sa' for a date, al-jayyid, good dates. So he had good dates, this man. He saw that another person had bad dates. Okay, so he said, okay, listen. Give me two sa'. Two sa' of what? Of your cheap dates. And I will give you one sa' of my quality dates. This is now riba, right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say to him? He said, "La taf'al, do not do this." This is a prohibition, right? He said, "Don't prohibit." He said, "Bi'il jam'a bid-darahimi thumma ibta' bid-darahimi janiyan." I'm a janiban. "La taf'al bi'il jam'a bid-darahimi thumma ibta' bid-darahimi janiban." Janiban. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La taf'al bi'il jam'a bid-darahimi thumma ibta' bid-darahimi janiban." The Prophet said to the man, "No, sell your quality dates." What do you do? Sell your quality dates. You got the money for it. Then buy it from this man. Buy it from him. The two sa' that you wanted. With money. If your quality is high, sell it. If it's worth a lot and you get more money for it, get that money and then buy his two from him. But to exchange one sa' of date for two sa', that's haram, it's riba. And it's not permissible. Some of the narration the Prophet said to the man when he already done the transaction, the Prophet said, "Rudduhu," turn it back. Because the transaction was null and void. Then this is an external evidence showing us that the prohibition here is fasad. So they all accept that one. There's no dispute about that one. They also showed what about if it doesn't show termination? Meaning they're saying it's prohibited, of course. We've already agreed that it's prohibition, right? That we're not talking about. We already took أن النهي المطلق. The unrestricted prohibition is what? What does it benefit? Haram. We already agreed on that. We're talking about the other point, which is, does it show null and void? Does it show termination? صح? We need to open our brain here. Here they said, the second one is if there comes an external evidence, it diverts it from what? What does it do? It diverts it from, there's external evidence that shows that it's not null and void. Yes, haram, but the action is not null and void. You're a sinner, but your action is not null and void. For example, the Prophet ﷺ statement where he said, لَا تَصُرُّ الْإِبِلَ وَالْغَنَمَ فَمَنِ ابْتَاعَ بَعْدُ فَهُوَ بِخَيْرِ النَّظَرَيْنِ بَعْدَ أَنْ يَحْلِبَهَا إِنْ شَاءَ أَمْسَكَهَا وَإِنْ شَاءَ رَدَّهَا وَصَاعًا مِنْ تَمْرِينَ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, لَا تَصُرُّ الْإِبِلَ, do not tie the udders of camels and sheep. Do not tie the udders of the camels and the sheep. What does the udders mean? Udders means the Arabs, what they would do is they would tie the genital of the animal. And so the milk would stay in there for a while. The breast and everything. It would stay in there for a long, 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 long time. And then it looks like when the animal is seen, that its breast is full. Oh, this animal looks like it produces a lot of milk. So the person is going to look at and touch it and say, SubhanAllah, this animal is swollen. It looks like it produces a lot of milk. And so when he takes it home and he milks it, he realizes that all of it was kept in there. You see? The Prophet said, لَا تَصُرُّ الْإِبِلَ وَالْغَنَمَ فَمَنِ بِتَاعَهَا بَعْدُ. Do not tie the udders of camels and sheep. Anyone who bought it, فَمَنِ بِتَاعَهَا بَعْدُ, if anyone brought it, فَهُوَ بِخَيْرِ النَّظَرَيْنِ, he has a choice after that. Whether he wants to pursue and let that contract be, and that transaction be, or whether he wants to terminate, he has the choice. إِنْ شَاءَ أَمْسَكَهَا وَإِنْ شَاءَ رَدَّهَا. But what about if he wants to bring it back? If he wants to bring the animal back, he brings it back وَصَاعًا مِنْ تَمْرٍ, and he has to give a what? A sa' of date. Why does he have to give sa' of date? Because he took some milk out. Now the Hanafiya, they came back and they said, this is riba. This is what? It's riba wa ma ila dhalik. How can you say it's riba? There's a nas sarih in this issue. There's a clear cut evidence in this issue. We don't want to go into that right now. The hadith is narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. This shows us that the action, the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا تَصُرُّ الْإِبِلَ وَالْغَنَمَ. Is it not a prohibition? Of course, we agree that it's haram. We're not talking about whether it's haram. We're talking about whether it's null and void, whether it's fasad. Okay, that's what we're talking about now. Does it show fasad? This showed us that it doesn't show fasad. How? Because if it showed fasad, the Prophet wouldn't have not said that فَوَّ بِخَيْرِ النَّظَرِينِ, he can choose. If it was null and void, the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, we would have said that they'd have to redo that transaction again. The fact that he can choose, the individual can choose, shows that the action is not fasid. It's not corrupt. That it's not corrupt. That's again external evidences. We're not talking about that. What are we talking about? The nahi, the unrestricted nahi, does it benefit? Does it indicate that it's null and void, that it's terminated without any external evidence? The Shaykh rahimahullah is of the opinion, and many of the usuliyin, that it does, that it shows fasad. And they have many evidence for this issue, but the author again, he suffices himself with a very famous evidence. And that is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. Anyone who does an action that's not from our affairs, then it's rejected. How is he trying to extract ruling from this? How? What's the wajhul istidlal? The Prophet ﷺ, he told us here that every action that's not from our religion, that is not from our legislation, is what? It's rejected. Rejected on the person. And the prohibition is not from our religion and it is not from our legislation. So it's rejected. And whatever is rejected, as the hadith mentioned, is what? Mardood. And whatever is rejected is what? Null and void. So from there, what did they take? Al-asla anna an-nahy al-mutlaq yaqtadi al-fasad. That the unrestricted prohibition, it benefits, it indicates that this thing is null and void, it's terminated. The author, rahimahullah, he then said, هذا وقاعدة المذهب في المنهي عنه هل يكون باطلا أو صحيحا مع التحريم كما يلي أن يكون النهي عائدا إلى ذات المنهي عنه أو شرطه فيكون باطلا أن يكون النهي عائدا إلى أمر خارج لا يتعلق بذات المنهي عنه ولا شرطه فلا يكون باطلا مثال العائد إلى ذات المنهي عنه في العبادة النهي عن صوم يوم العيدين ومثال العائد إلى ذاته في المعاملة النهي عن البيع بعد النداء الجمعة الثاني ممن تلزمه الجمعة ومثال العائد إلى شرطه في العبادة النهي عن لبس الرجل ثوب الحرير فستر العورة شرط لصحة الصلاة فإذا سترها بثوب منهي عنه لم تصح الصلاة لعود النهي إلى شرطه ومثال العائد إلى شرطه في المعاملة النهي عن بيع الحمل فالعلم بالمبيع شرط لصحة البيع فإذا باع الحمل لم يصح البيع لعود النهي إلى شرطه ومثال النهي العائد إلى أمر خارج في العبادة النهي عن لبس الرجل عمامة الحرير النهي عن لبس الرجل عمامة الحرير فلو صلى وعليه عمامة حرير لم تبطل صلاته لأن النهي لا يعود إلى ذات الصلاة ولا شرطها ومثال العائد إلى أمر خارج في المعاملة النهي عن الغش فلو باع شيئا من الغش لم يبطل البيع لأن النهي لا يعود إلى ذات البيع ولا شرطه.
The principle according to the school of thought, Hanbali, concerning those things that have been forbidden, whether they are correct or not, are as follows. Number one, the prohibition returns back to the very thing itself being prohibited or its condition, thus making it incorrect. Number two, the prohibition returns back to something other than itself or its conditions, therefore not being incorrect. An example of the first principle in worship is the prohibition on fasting on the 2 days of Eid. An example of the first principle in dealing with other people is the prohibition of selling after the second call to the Friday prayer for whoever the day of Friday is obligatory. An example of the second principle in worship is the prohibition of a man wearing silk so he covers his awra, fulfilling one of the conditions of prayer. But if he covers his awra with a forbidden cloth, his prayer is invalid because the prohibition returns to the condition of the prayer being valid. An example of the second principle when dealing with other people is the prohibition on the sale of a fetus load. Because knowledge of what you are buying is a condition for the validity of the transaction. If a fetus is sold, the transaction is not valid due to the condition of the prohibition. An example of a prohibition returning to an external issue with regards to worship is the wearing of a silk turban by a man. So if he prays whilst wearing a silk turban, it does not invalidate his prayer because the prohibition does not fall back on the prayer or its condition to be accepted. An example of a prohibition returning to an external issue with regards to transactions is the prohibition of fraud. If something is sold fraudulently, that does not invalidate the sale because the transaction does not return back to the very thing itself or its condition.
The author, rahimahullah, he goes into al-qa'idah عند الحنابلة, principles according to the Hanabila, which is the indication of the prohibition, whether something is terminated or not. What we have to understand is the prohibition goes to one of three things. Okay, the prohibition goes to one of three things. The first thing that it either goes back to is إِلَى ذَاتِ الْمَنْهِيَّ عَنْهُ, the thing that's been prohibited itself. The thing itself. The prohibition is going back to the thing itself. The second one is, it goes back to the condition, a prerequisite of this action. So it's not going back to the thing itself, but it's going back to a condition that's stipulated to this particular thing. I'll give example for all of them. And the third one is an external issue that the prohibition is connected to. Let me explain each one in details. The first one is the prohibition which goes back to the thing itself. And that means it goes back to either the pillar. What is the pillar? The pillar is the essence of the action, right? Just like the pillar is inside the building, there's a pillar within actions. Okay? For example, al-ba'i'u, the one who is selling. Al-mushtari, the one who's buying. Al-thamanu, the money. Al-muthmanu, the product. All of those are what? All of those are four pillars when it comes to buying. Four pillars. The one who's buying, the one who's selling, the thing that's been sold, and the money that's been given. For example, if a young kid sells to a crazy person khamar in exchange for swine, this bay' is all haram. All of the four pillars have been destroyed. Because the prohibition goes back to each of those four. A young child cannot sell. A sabi cannot sell. Okay? A majnoon cannot also buy. Because he's not mukallaf. Khamar cannot be sold. And nor can swine be sold. So he's giving him khamar for swine to a crazy person. The one who's selling it is a child. These are four of the pillars that we mentioned for bay'ah. All of them have been nullified because all of them have prohibitions. And the prohibition goes back to the pillars of what? Al-bay'ah. So this is fasad, corrupt, null and void. It doesn't exist. This transaction did not take place. Another one was the condition, right? A prohibition that refers back to or goes back to the condition. What does it mean, the condition? Again, the condition is outside the what? It's outside the ibadah, but it's a prerequisite for the ibadah. For example, al-tahara, or covering your private part, or facing the qibla in the prayer, all of them are what? They're all shurut, they're conditions. Number three is what? إِلَىٰ أَمْرٍ خَارِجِينَ, an external thing. The prohibition here is going back to an external thing. So it's not going back to the thing itself, and it's also not going back to what? And it's not going back to the prerequisite. So what is it going back to? It's going back to an external thing. Something that's not a rukun, or something that's not a shart. And what is it going back to? It's going back to amrun khariji, an external thing. For example, a person who sells, the process that he prohibited, right? To artificially, to inflate price. To artificially, you don't want to buy something. So somebody's buying a product and you say, I'll give it to you better. You were never intending to buy it. And so you just want to get the price up and up and up and up. That's all you wanted. You with me? The Prophet ﷺ, naha anil najsi. The Prophet ﷺ, he prohibited what? Anil najsi. He prohibited artificially inflate prices. If a person buys something like that, this bay is not null. It's not terminated. It's not null and void. Because it doesn't go back to the pillars, nor does it go back to the conditions. It doesn't. Here what we have to understand, inshaAllah ta'ala, and we're going to speak about it tomorrow in our class, inshaAllah ta'ala, is the chapters of fiqh are two. What are they? And the Shaykh mentioned it here. Ibadah and what? Mu'amala. How many did we just mention right now that the prohibition goes back to? Three, right? Al-a'idu ila dhati al-manhiya anhu. Al-a'idu ila shartihi. Al-a'idu ila amrin khariji, sah? That which goes back to the pillar and the essence of the thing. That which goes back to the condition. And the third one is that which goes back to an external issue. It goes back to external issue. Ibadah has those three, and the mu'amalat has those three. How many do you have in total? How much do you have in total? Six. Those six are the prohibitions that you find, whether in ibadat or in mu'amalat. Those are the six. That which either goes back to إِلَى ذَاتِ الْمَنْهِيُّ عَنْهُ, or it goes back to the conditions, or it goes back to an external thing. These are the suwar that come from it. These are the forms that come from it. And that's the six forms that the author is mentioning here, by the way. Shaykh Muhammad Salih Al-Uthaymeen is mentioning, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So the Shaykh rahimahullahu ta'ala, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih Al-Uthaymeen, he goes into a al-qa'ida inda al-hanabila, a qa'ida according to the scholars of the Hanbali madhab. When it comes to the dalalatul nahi, the indication of the prohibition, what does the nahi indicate? What does it show? He mentions, the scholars are of the opinion that the prohibition either is showing that this act is now nullified. So Allah prohibited something and His Messenger prohibited something. If someone does that prohibition in the act, is that action nullified or is it not? We know that the prohibition, it shows tahrim. The nahi shows tahrim. We've already taken that. Okay? And we also discussed whether the nahi, the prohibition, shows fawriya, that this needs to be done straight away. The question here is, does it show fasad? Does it show corruption? Does it show that this act is nullified or not? Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen mentioned something very important, which is that the prohibition, whether it shows that this act is nullified or not, it goes back to three things. Number one, أَنْ يَكُونَ النَّهْيُ عَائِدًا إِلَى ذَاتِ الْمَنْهِيُّ عَنْهُ. The prohibition goes back to the thing that's being prohibited. It goes back to its essence. In other words, it goes back to a pillar from its pillars. That's one. Number two, أَنْ يَكُونَ النَّهْيُ, the prohibition, عَائِدًا, goes back to إِلَى شَرْطِهِ, its prerequisites, its conditions. And number three is أَنْ يَكُونَ النَّهْيُ عَائِدًا إِلَى أَمْرٍ خَارِجِي, that the prohibition goes back to an external matter, external thing. Those are the three in which a prohibition goes back to. The first two, which is if it goes back to the essence, i.e. the pillar, or the second, which is if it goes back to the condition and the prerequisite, then it's null and void. And I'll give an example, inshallah ta'ala. But if it goes back to an external matter, then it's not null and void. Let's take an example for each one. The first one is, أَنْ يَكُونَ النَّهْيُ عَائِدًا إِلَى ذَاتِ الْمَنْهِيُّ عَنْهُ, that the prohibition goes back to the thing that's prohibited. An example for that is, if a child, he sells to an insane person. First of all, we know that selling has four pillars, right? Buying and selling and trading has four pillars. There's condition, there's pillar, the pillar is the one who's selling. That's one pillar. The second pillar is the one who's buying. The third one is the money that's being given. And the fourth, which is the product. Those are the four pillars in which buying and selling is built on. Now, a child is selling to an insane. So a child can't sell. An insane can't buy. So two pillars already missing. He's selling it to him بِلَحْمِ الْخِنْزِيرِ. He's giving him pig meat. Okay, he's giving khamar and he wants him to give him pig meat. All four pillars are prohibited. So because all of them are prohibited and they all go back to the essence of that which is prohibited, which is the bay'ah, all of it, those four are all prohibited, then this bay'ah is null and void. The second one is, it goes back to the condition. It goes back to the condition. Such as the prohibition that goes back to the tahara. The tahara is a prerequisite, it's a condition. Okay? You're not allowed to pray a salah without tahara. You're prohibited from that. If a person does that prohibition, then his salah is null and void. Because it goes back to what? It goes back to the shart, the prerequisite. The third one, it goes back to an external issue. النَّهْيُ الْعَائِدُ إِلَىٰ أَمْرٍ خَارِجِي. It goes back to an external matter. This one is not null and void. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prohibited, نَهَى النَّبِيُّ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam عَنِ النَّجْسِ. عَنِ النَّجْسِ means what? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prohibited from artificially inflating price. Najshi is a what? Is to artificially inflate price. This is prohibited, but it doesn't go back to the pillar, and it doesn't go back to the prerequisite. It is prohibited, لكن فيكون البيع صحيحا. But the transaction is sahih. Now the Sheikh mentioned, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, he mentioned that the prohibition, they go back to these three, and they occur in two chapters of ibadah. Sorry, two chapters of fiqh. They enter the chapter of ibadah and the chapter of mu'amala, transaction. So three enter ibadah and three enter mu'amala, transaction. For example, let me give an example of each one. The prohibition that goes back to ibadah, there are three. إِلَى ذَاتِ الْمَنْهِيُ عَنْهُ إِلَى شَرْطِهِ إِلَى أَمْرٍ خَارِجِي. I'm going to give an example of each one, inshallah ta'ala. And also, النَّهْيُ قَدْ يَعُودُ إِلَى مُعَامَلَةٍ. إِلَى ذَاتِ الْمَنْهِيُ عَنْهُ إِلَى شَرْطِهِ إِلَى أَمْرٍ خَارِجِي. Six, three or three, which is six, they go into ibadah and mu'amala. Let's go to the first one, which is the one that goes back to the prohibition that goes back to إلى ذات المنهي عنه في العبادة. In عبادة لكن. For example, the prohibition of fasting on يوم العيدين, the two Eids. Null and void. It's null and void. The second one is, second form is, the prohibition that goes back to the مُعَامَلَة إلى ذات المنهي عنه. An example for that one is the prohibition of selling after the second proclaim, a second calling of Jum'ah. Of course, this is referring to the one who Jum'ah is obligatory on him. This again is what? This is null and void. The second, third form is النَّهْيُ, the prohibition, يَعُودُ النَّهْيُ إِلَىٰ شَرْطِ الْمَنْهِيُ عَنُ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ. The prerequisite for what? The prohibition that falls in prerequisite of ibadah. Such as the prohibition عَنْ لُبْسِ الرَّجُلِ ثَوْبَ الْحَرِيرِ. The man wearing silk clothes when he's praying the salah. That's according to the madhab of the Hanabila. Shaykh ibn al-Uthaymeen, on the other hand, doesn't hold that opinion, the statement that he said. He chose that the salah is sahih with a thawb which is harir. And he believes that the prohibition here is not the condition. He believes it goes back to Amrun khariji, an external matter, which will come to us soon, inshallah ta'ala. The fourth form, the fourth way that it comes is that the prohibition goes back to the prerequisite in transaction, which is the mu'amala. And an example for this one is النهي عن بيع الحمل, selling a pregnant animal. No one knows this animal. It's a prerequisite for transaction. It's corrupt and it's null and void, this transaction. The fifth one is the prohibition going back to an external matter in ibadah, such as the example that the Shaykh brought right now, which is the man wearing silk in Salah, for instance. Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen believes this, it falls under this one. And the sixth one is the prohibition that goes back to إِلَىٰ أَمْرٍ خَارِجِي فِي مُعَامَلَةٍ, in transaction. External matter in transaction. And this one, for example, is إِذَا تَلَقَّ الْجَلَبَ, that meeting the merchant before they enter the city. The person goes and meets them outside and he sells and he buys from him. The bay' is sahih here. The bay' is sahih, even though it's prohibited to do so. You know someone's going to come into the city, they haven't seen the prices in the city or whatnot. You meet them outside and you buy from them. The Prophet, he prohibited to meet the jalab, the merchants outside. But if someone does that, then the bay' is sahih, لِأَنَّ النَّهِيَ عَائِدْ إِلَىٰ أَمْرٍ خَارِجِي, because the prohibition is an external matter. Those are the types of prohibitions. وَلِذَلِكَ the Hanabila, they have a qa'ida, which is, the Hanabila have the principle, which is الْأَصْلُ, the default position is أَنَّ النَّهِيَ دُلُّ عَلَى الْفَسَادِ, that the prohibition, it indicates the prohibitions that come in the Quran and the Sunnah, they show that this thing is null and void. إِلَّا إِذَا عَادَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرٍ خَارِجِيٍّ فِي عِبَادَةٍ أَوْ مُعَامَلَةٍ, unless it goes back to an external matter in ibadah or in transaction. And we gave the example for all of that. وَلِذَلِكَ ابْنُ رَجَبْ الْحَنْبَلِي, he mentions this in his Qawa'id book, and other scholars have discussed it. نعم. The author then said, وَقَدْ يَخْرُجُ النَّهْيُ عَنِ التَّحْرِيمِ إِلَىٰ مَعَانٍ أُخْرَىٰ لِدَلِيلٍ يَقْتَضِي ذَلِكَ فَمِنْهَا الْكَرَاهَةَ وَمَثَّلُوا لِذَلِكَ بِقَوْلِهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم لَا يَمَسَّنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ ذَكَرَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ وَهُوَ يَبُولُ فَقَدْ قَالَ الْجُمْهُورُ إِنَّ النَّهْيَ هُنَا لِلْكَرَاهَةَ لِأَنَّ الذَّكَرَ بَضْعَةٌ مِنَ الْإِنْسَانِ وَالْحِكْمَةُ مِنَ النَّهْيِ تَنْزِيهُ الْيَمِينِ الثاني الإرشاد مثل قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم لمعاذ لا تدعن أن تقول دبر كل صلاة اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك.
The format of prohibition sometimes can be used for other than that which has been forbidden when evidence shows otherwise, as in the following cases. Number one, dislike. The example that is given is of the saying of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, do not let any of you touch his private part with his right hand when he urinates. The majority say that the prohibition here is for it being disliked, because his private part is part of the body, and the wisdom of forbidding it is to keep the right hand pure. Number two, guidance. Such as the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, never leave off saying after every prayer, O Allah, help me to remember you, give thanks to you, and worship you well.
The Shaykh rahimahullah, before he mentioned to us أن النهي المطلق يقتضي التحريم, the unrestricted prohibition, what does it benefit? Haram, tahrim. The unrestricted prohibition, it benefits us, التحريم, that it's haram. Then he mentioned things that can leave that asal. Times when the unrestricted prohibition is no longer haram. And he mentioned, رحمه الله تعالى, two. The first one is, it becomes the prohibition, the nahi becomes what? Karaha. And of course, it all has to be qarina, because a nahi al-mutlaq, we said. The unrestricted prohibition is different. This one, there's a qarina, there's a factor, an external force that's pushing it away from the default position. The first one is al-karaha, that is disliked. And the hadith that the Shaykh brought is, لَا يَمَسَّنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ ذَكَرَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ وَهُوَ يَبُولُ. Shaykh here, he said, وَمَثَّلُوا. He used the word وَمَثَّلُوا in Arabic language. إِشْعَارًا بِأَنَّهُ لَا يَرْضِيهِ. He's trying to give that feeling that he's not pleased with this example. What's funny is that he himself, in his sharh of Zad al-Mustaqni', Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, he mentioned it's disliked as well. But here he said, وَمَثَّلُوا. وَاللَّهُ عَلَمْ. عَلَى كُلِّ حَالْ لَا يَمَسَّنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ ذَكَرَهُ بِيَمِينِي وَهُوَ يَبُولُ. Here he's trying to say that it is karaha, is disliked, for the person to touch their private part with their right hand whilst they are urinating. The overwhelming majority of the scholars, they said here, it is not haram. It's karaha to tanzih. It's disliked. But there's the qarina that is needed. Where is the qarina? They said that the qarina is, the qarina is that the private part was mentioned to be part of the body. And everyone knows that the body is not, that the body isn't haram to touch. The second one that the Shaykh mentioned, which is al-irshad. Al-irshad is to guide someone. Even though you're prohibiting them, but it's just a guidance. You're just guiding them from something you want them to stay away from. Like the Prophet ﷺ said to Mu'adh, he said to him, لا تدعنا, لا تدعنا, do not leave. He said he was guiding him here. Sighatu al-nahi, it comes in the form of a prohibition. And na'am, yes, the aslu fi al-nahi al-mutlaq yaqtadi al-tahrim. Yes, the unrestricted prohibition benefits haram. But here, there's a sarif, there's a qarina, something that diverted it, which is the dua that the Messenger made for him after that, which is, Allahumma inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husn ibadatik. That's what San'ani mentioned in his kitab, Subul al-Salam. The author then said, من يدخل في الخطاب بالأمر والنهي الذي يدخل في الخطاب بالأمر والنهي هو المكلف وهو البالغ العاقل فخرج بقولنا البالغ الصغير فلا يكلف إلا بالأمر والنهي تكليفا مساويا للتكليف البالغ ولكنه يؤمر بالعبادات بعد التمييز تمرينا له على الطاعة ويمنع من المعاصي ليعتاد الكف عنها وخرج بقولنا العاقل المجنون فلا يكلف بالأمر والنهي ولكنه يمنع مما يكون فيه تعد على غيره أو إفساد ولو فعل المأمور به لم يصح منه الفعل لعدم قصد الامتثال منه ولا يرد على هذا إيجاب الزكاة والحقوق المالية في مال الصغير والمجنون لأن إيجاب هذه مربوط بأسباب معينة متى وجدت ثبت الحكم متى وجدت ثبت الحكم فهي منظور فيها إلى السبب لا إلى الفاعل والتكليف بالأمر والنهي شامل للمسلمين والكفار لكن الكافر لا يصح منه فعل المأمور به حال كفره لقوله تعالى وما منعهم أن تقبل منهم نفقاتهم وما منعهم أن تقبل منهم نفقاتهم إلا أنهم كفروا بالله وبرسوله ولا يؤمر بقضائه إذا أسلم لقوله تعالى قل للذين كفروا إن ينتهوا يغفر لهم ما قد سلف وقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم لعمر بن العاص أما علمت يا وقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم لعمر بن العاص أما علمت يا عمرو إن الإسلام يهدم ما كان قبله وإنما يعاقب على تركه إذا مات على الكفر لقوله تعالى عن جواب المجرمين إذا سئلوا ما سلككم في سقر ما سلككم في سقر قالوا لم نكن من المصلين ولم نكن نطعم المسكين وكنا نخوض مع الخائضين وكنا نكذب بيوم الدين حتى أتانا اليقين.
Who is being addressed by the legislation to implement the commands and prohibitions? The one who is being addressed for the commands and prohibition is the mukallif, the one who has been charged to carry out all those obligations that are applicable to him, an adult past puberty and of sane mind. What is excluded from our word adult is a child, who isn't charged with the commands and prohibitions in the same way an adult is, but is ordered to do acts of worship in order to help him get used to showing obedience to Allah, and likewise he should be prevented from sins so as to customize him with withholding from them. And what is excluded from our word sane is an insane person, as he is not charged with commands and prohibitions, but is prevented from such actions that may be a transgression against others or a perversion. And even if he doesn't, does an action from the things that have been commanded, it would not be deemed correct simply because he did not intend by it to comply with the command in the first place. This does not, however, refer to the obligation of zakat and the financial rights of the child or insane person, because the obligation is tied to certain reasons. So whenever they are found, then the ruling applies because it relies on the reason and not the state of the one doing it. And the burden of obeying the commands and abstaining from the prohibitions is leveled at all Muslims and non-Muslims alike. Only the non-Muslims will have their deeds accepted while they are in a state of disbelief due to the statement of the Most High. And what prevents their expenditures from being accepted from them but that they have disbelieved in Allah and His Messenger? They are not ordered to make up for it if they accept Islam, as the statement of the Most High says, "Say to those who have disbelieved that if they cease, what has previously occurred will be forgiven for them." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Amr ibn al-As, "Do you not know, O Amr, that Islam cancels what came before it? Rather, he is only punished if he dies on disbelief." This is indicated in the statement of the Most High concerning the reply of the criminals when they asked, "What put you into Saqar?" They will say, "We were not of those who prayed, nor did we used to feed the poor, and we used to enter into vain discourse with those who engaged in it, and we used to deny the day of recompense until they came to us the certainty."
The Shaykh Rahimahullah, he clarified and he explained to us the commands and the prohibitions. He spoke about Al-Amr wa Nahi. Now he went into who enters when the Sharia, the legislator, commands and when he prohibits. Who is the one who's being spoken to? Who is being addressed here in these commandments and these prohibitions? The Shaykh mentions that the ones who enter it is Al-Mukallaf. Who is a Mukallaf? It is a person who has two characteristics. Al-Aqil al-Baligh. He's reached age of puberty and he's sane. So when you say Al-Baligh, Al-Bulugh, reaches age of puberty, then we're talking about the child who hasn't reached puberty, is not in there. غير المميز. So the child who hasn't reached age of puberty, he's not being addressed here. But there's a question here. What about if the child can, he hasn't reached age of puberty, but he can tell, he's reached tamyiz, he can distinguish more things. We know if he can't distinguish anything, bittifaq al-usuliyin, bittifaq al-ulama, by consensus, if he can't distinguish anything, then na'am, he is not being addressed. Like in there's a dispute. What about if he hasn't reached age of puberty, like in he's a mumayyiz, he can distinguish things. Okay, we're going to see how, what is it that they say that the child can distinguish something. But this is a dispute. Even though the overwhelming usuleen, the overwhelming scholars of usul al-fiqh, they're of the opinion, he's also not mukallaf. He's also not mukallaf. And the khitab al-shara, the addressing of the sharia, is not talking to him. So the question here is, the mumayyiz, how do the usul, those who say that, yes, of course, if he's mumayyiz, he doesn't reach age of puberty, yeah, he's a mukallaf. How do they identify who's a mumayyiz? They took two approaches. The first one is, ضَبْطُهُ بِالسِّنِ. They said, 7, he's a mumayyiz. And the second one is, ضَبْطُهُ بِالْفَهْمِ. They said, oh, he understands what's been said to him. Like when he's asked questions, he can answer questions. The ones who used the 7, they said our evidence for that is If the child reaches seven, you command him the prayer. As the Prophet ﷺ said, مُرُّ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ بِالصَّلَاةِ لِسَبْعٍ. Command your children the salah when they are seven. وَضْرِبُوهُمْ عَلَيْهَا لِعَشْرٍ. And discipline them when they are ten. And they said that you stop them from the sins. There are other scholars who said that tamyiz is not a mukallaf. It's only bulugh. They responded and they said, ذَلِكَ مِنْ بَابِ التَّأْلِيفِ لَا مِنْ بَابِ التَّكْلِيفِ. This is to bring his heart closer to the religion. It's to teach him and nurture him upon the practice. It's not that it's a burden on him. Okay? But they said, what about the beating? I mean, the disciplining that you do when he's 10? The scholars, they said that the taklif, it talks about the punishments in the hereafter. What's happening in this dunya, it's not a taklif. So even if he's getting disciplined on this earth, that doesn't show a taklif. Is he going to be disciplined? Is he going to be punished the day of judgment, the child, if he doesn't pray at the age of 10? No, it's not. That's what they said is taklif. The second condition is al-aql, that the child, the person is sane. So the one who is majnoon, the one who is insane, he's not mukallaf, he's not burdened with the commandments and the prohibitions, because he doesn't have a aql. He's not sane. And al-aql manat al-taklif. The scholars, they say that aql is what you are burdened for. Without it, there's no taklif. And the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, رُفِعَ الْقَلَمُ عَنْ ثَلَاثَةٍ. The pen is lifted from three. عَنِ الْمَجْنُونِ حَتَّى يَفِيقَ. The insane one until he regains sanity. وَعَنِ الصَّبِيِّ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ. And the child until he reaches age of puberty. وَعَنِ النَّائِمِ. And also the one who is sleeping. حَتَّى يَسْتَيْقِظ. Until he wakes up. But the person who is the guardian of the insane has to prevent him from every act that might lead to transgression of other people's wealth, or other people's belongings, because it can cause other people harm. And if he does corrupt and destroy a group of people's wealth, then money would be taken from his to be paid back. But if he prays a salah and he's insane, or he fasts, or he does hajj, it won't be accepted from him. Because what is needed for the ibadah? Niyatul imtithal. The person has to have the intention to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the insane doesn't have that. He doesn't know what he's doing. Nor does the child know what he's doing. Nor does the child know what he's doing. The author then, rahimahullah, goes into Islam is not a condition. We know bulugh is a condition for taklif, and al-aql is a condition for taklif. Lakin Islam is not a condition for taklif. The Shaykh mentions this. And this is a mas'ala that the usuliyin talk about, which is halil kufaru mukhatabuna fi furu' al-shari'ah. Are the disbelievers being addressed in the sub-branches of the religion? It's a long discussion. The Shaykh takes the opinion that they are being addressed. Meaning, are they being spoken to when the salah and the zakat and the psalm and the hajj is spoken about? Is it talking to the disbelievers as well? The Shaykh brings a couple of evidences. He brings the ayah from the Quran where Allah says, مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. When the disbelievers are placed in the hellfire, they will be questioned, how did you end up in Saqara? How did you end up in the hellfire? And the first thing that they say is, قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. We never used to pray. So this shows that they have been punished for not praying. But someone might say, isn't this talking about the believers? How do you know this is talking about the disbelievers? In that same ayah, they said that وَكُنَّا نُكَذِّبُ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ. We used to disbelieve in the Day of Judgment. Meaning they were kuffar then. That's an indication that they were what? That they were kuffar. So they were getting punished for leaving the salah. They were not feeding the masakeen. And they were lying. They were liars. These are all furu'. issues, they get punished for it. The second evidence that the Shaykh brought was the hadith of Amr ibn al-As in Sahih Muslim, where the Prophet ﷺ said to Amr ibn al-As, أَمَا عَلِمْتَ يَا عَمْرَ Amr, did you not know أَنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ يَهْدِمُ مَا كَانَ قَبْلَهُ Did you not know that Islam nullifies and it demolishes everything that was done before it? So the hadith has a mantuq and it has a mafhumul mukhalafa. صح? The mantuq of the hadith is what I just mentioned. Is that the Messenger ﷺ told him that Islam will nullify every shortcoming and mistakes that you have come with before. That's the mantuq, that's the direct speech of the hadith. But there's a mafhum. Okay? By the way, just before I go to the mafhum, the mantuq, what did the Prophet say? أَمَا عَلِمْتَ يَا عَمْرَ أَنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ يَهْدِمُ مَا كَانَ The ma here is a mawsoola, tufidu al-umum. I mean, Islam nullifies everything. Everything that was done before you became a Muslim. Everything. That's the mantuq of the hadith. That is what the hadith is directly saying. What about the mafhum al-mukhalafa, the reverse understanding? Which is, if he didn't become a Muslim, he would have been punished for every sin. So then what's entering there? Furu' al-Sharia. The sub-branch of the Sharia as well, because the ma' is mawsoola. So the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he's of the opinion that the kuffar are mukhatabuna bi furu' al-Sharia, that the disbelievers are being addressed in the sub-branches of the religion. Some may bring an i'tirad, which is, they might oppose that by saying, how is that possible? When Allah said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَغْسِلُوا وُجُهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ Those of you who believe, if you stand up to the prayer, then wash your faces and your hands to your elbows, including the elbows, of course. The question here is, they're saying that Allah said at the beginning of the ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Those of you who believe. Okay? Those of you who believe. The question here is, the mu'mineen are being spoken to here. And the disbelievers are not being spoken to. So how can you say that the kuffar are mukhatabuna fi furu' al-shari'ah? The scholars, they responded and they said, this is a khitab al-tashrifi, la khitab al-takhsisi. Okay? And you can find this more in the Ghaythu al-Hawami'ah, which is a sharh on Jam'u Jawami'. Khitab al-Tashrifi. Allah is addressing them out of respect and honor for the believers. But it's not that it's specific to them. La min babi al-takhsisi. It's not from that angle of it being specific and unique to the believers. It's min babi al-tashrif. It's the angle of honoring them and respecting the people of Iman. As for if a disbeliever, the Shaykh mentions, he comes with righteous actions like salah and sadaqah and siyam and hajj, it won't be accepted from him. Because he didn't come with the prerequisite, which is Islam. And the Shaykh brought the ayah, وَمَا مَنَعَهُمْ Nothing prevented أَن تُقْبَلَ مِنْهُمْ for it to be accepted from them. نَفَقَاتُهُمْ The charity that they gave, إِلَّا أَنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَبِرَسُولِهِ Except that they disbelieved in Allah and His Messenger. And another ayah, وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا We brought their actions forward, and then Allah says, we made it هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا Like it doesn't exist, like null and void. And if he takes Islam, he will not be commanded to bring back the ibadat that he missed. Why? تَرْغِيبًا لَهُ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ To urge him to come into Islam. وَتَخْفِيفًا عَلَيْهِ Imagine if somebody was told, all of those days what you missed, you have to bring it back. He wouldn't want to come into Islam, would he? So targhiban fil islami, targhiban lahu fil islami wa takhfifan alayhi. And the evidence that the scholars they used is the ayah, قُلْ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا Say to them, Muhammad, the ones who disbelieved, إِيَّنْتَهُ If they leave off, إِيَّنْتَهُ If they leave off what they did before, and they stay away from it, meaning they repent from it, يُغْفَرْ لَهُمْ مَا قَدِ السَّلَفِ They will be forgiven for everything. And the hadith of Amr ibn al-As also shows that. The Then the Shaykh rahimahullah, he said here, مَوَانِعُ التَّكْلِيفِ لِلتَّكْلِيفِ مَوَانِعُ مِنْهَا الْجَهْلُ وَالنِّسْيَانُ وَالْإِكْرَاهُ لِقَوْلِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَجَاوَزَ عَنْ أُمَّةِ الْخَطَأِ وَالنِّسْيَانِ وَمَا اسْتُكْرِهُ عَلَيْهِ رواه ابن ماجة والبيهقي وله شواهد من الكتاب والسنة تدل على صحته فالجهل عدم العلم فمتى فعل المكلف فالجهل عدم العلم فمتى فعل المكلف محرما جاهلا بتحريمه فلا شيء عليه كمن تكلم في الصلاة جاهلا بتحريم الكلام ومتى ترك واجبا جاهلا بوجوبه لم يلزمه قضاؤه إذا كان قد فات وقته بالدليل أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يأمر المسيء في صلاته وكان لا يطمئن فيها لم يأمره بقضاء ما فات من الصلاة وإنما أمره بفعل الصلاة الحاضرة على الوجه المشروع والنسيان ذهول القلب عن شيء معلوم فمتى فعل محرما ناسيا فلا شيء عليه كمن أكل في الصيام ناسيا ومتى ترك واجبا ناسيا فلا شيء عليه حال نسيانه ولكن عليه فعله إذا ذكره لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من نسي صلاة فليصليها إذا ذكرها والإكراه إلزام الشخص بما لا يريد فمن أكره على شيء محرم فلا شيء عليه كمن أكره على الكفر وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان ومن أكره على ترك واجب فلا شيء عليه حال الإكراه وعليه قضاء إذا زال كمن أكره على ترك الصلاة حتى خرج وقتها فإنه يلزمه قضاؤها إذا زال الإكراه وتلك الموانع إنما هي في حق الله لأنه مبني على العفو والرحمة أما في حقوق المخلوقين فلا تمنع من ضمان ما يجب ضمانه إذا لم يرضى صاحب الحق بسقوطه والله أعلم.
Things that prevent someone from having to carry the ordinance laid down by the Sharia, such as ignorance, forgetfulness, and coercion due to what the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah has forgiven my ummah for its mistakes, what they forget, and what they are forced to do. Narrated by Ibn Majah and Al-Bayhaqi, there are also corroborating evidences which from the Quran and the Sunnah which prove its authenticity. Lack of knowledge. So whenever a mukallaf violates a prohibition and aware of it being so, then there is nothing upon him. Sin, like someone speaking in the prayer while being ignorant of the prohibition of speech in the prayer. And whenever he leaves an obligation not aware of it being obligatory, he is not to be ordered to make up for it as long as the time for it has passed. Using as evidence the Prophet ﷺ when he did not order the person who prayed badly in his prayers, in which he was not tranquil, to make up all the missed prayers, but ordered him to pray the current prayer according to the correct way. Forgetfulness, absence of mind for something known. So if someone falls into doing a prohibited act out of forgetfulness, then there is no sin upon him, such as the one who eats while fasting due to forgetfulness. When someone forgets to fulfill a duty, then there is nothing upon him while he is in that state of forgetfulness. However, he must do so when he remembers due to saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever forgets the prayer, then let him pray when he remembers to do so. Coercion, forcing a person into doing what he does not want to. So whosoever is forced to do something forbidden, then there is no sin upon him, such as the one who is forced into acts of disbelief, blasphemy, while his heart is at peace with faith. Also the one who is forced to not fulfill an obligation, then there is no sin upon while he is being forced. And that he fulfills it when he is no longer being forced. And like the one who is forced to miss the prayer until after its allotted time, then he must make up for that missed prayer as soon as he is under no coercion. And all these things are with regards to the right of Allah, which is based on forgiveness and mercy. As for the rights of the creation, then these things will not prevent whatsoever commitments that have been made are kept to if the person who is involved does not choose to overlook it, and Allah knows best.
The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, when he mentioned the shurut al-taklif, the conditions and the prerequisites for taklif, he mentioned the preventing factors, the things that prevent the taklif. And the scholars, they call it awarid al-ahliyah. That's the name that is given. And the people who speak about this the most, who talk about it the most, are the Usuliyu al-Hanafiyya. The Hanafi Usuliyin. They're the ones who speak about it the most. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he mentioned three from the Mawani' al-Takleef. He mentioned three of them. Al-Jahl wal-Nisyan wal-Ikrah. And the reason why he mentioned these three is because they're all present in one hadith. The hadith is the Prophet ﷺ statement. The hadith is found by Ibn Majah and Bayhaqi narrated it. Min hadithi Abdullah ibn Abbas. Inna Allah tajawaz an ummati al-khata wal-nisyan wa mastukrihu alayhi. And the word al-khata, al-jahlu is inside al-khata. Okay, the Shaykh mentioned al-jahlu, so the jahl and the khata are together. And the second one is al-nisyanu. And the third one is وَمَسْتُكْرِهُ عَلَيْهِ. We're going to go through each one, inshallah ta'ala, in great details. The Shaykh rahimahullah did a very good job here. When he mentioned the hadith in the wording of إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَجَاوَزَ. He used that wording. And this is in opposition to the usuliyin, who are very ignorant when it comes to hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. One person, if he does a mistake, the usuliyin, they don't verify hadith, so they will just copy that. And they narrate that hadith in what? Rufi'a an ummati. And that word in Rufi'a an ummati, Zayla'i in his kitab Nasb al-Raya, which is the takhrij of the kitab Al-Hidayah by Marghinani, he mentions, أَنَّهُ لَا يُوجَدُ بِهَذَا اللَّفْظِ فِي كُتُبِ الْحَدِيثِ. That the word Rufi'a an ummati, Rufi'a an ummati, he said that this wording has not been found in any of the books of hadith. Okay? But this hadith that the Shaykh brought himself, عَلَّهُ الْبُوصِيرِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ. Al-Busiri, he mentioned that this hadith is weak. Okay? And he said that there's a disconnection between Ata and Ibn Abbas. And he mentioned that Ata narrated from Ubaidillah ibn Umayr al-Laythi. لكن الإمام النووي graded this hadith to be Hassan. And also, وَجَوَّدَ إِسْنَادَهُ. The chain of the hadith, Ibn Kathir considered it to be the chain to be good. Because he said, Ubaid Ibn Umayr al-Laythi, he said he's a thiqa. And Shaykh al-Albani authenticated it, rahimahullahu ta'ala. He authenticated it in his kitab Irwa' al-Ghalil, Shaykh al-Albani. And Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, just to be on the safe side, he said something after he brought the hadith. He said, وَلَهُ شَوَاهِدٌ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ تَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ صِحَتِي. He just said that the hadith has a shawahid. And this shows that the word shawahid is used for what? Quranic verses can be used for shawahid. Look, he says, وَلَهُ شَوَاهِدٌ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ تَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ صِحَتِي. The shawahid from the kitab and the sunnah that shows the authenticity of this hadith. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen is just trying to leave the khilaf. Okay? And the evidence that he means that are backing up this hadith, even if some scholars have considered it to be weak, he's referring to which shawahid? The ayah, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِنَّ سِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. And the ayah, إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَا وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنُّ بِالْإِيمَانِ. Those are the three. صح? إِكْرَاهَ النِّسْيَانِ is in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 286. And in Surah Al-Nahl, ayah 106 is the ikrah. And also the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, Abu Dawud and Ibn Majah, min hadith Aisha, وَلَهُ طُرُقٌ يُقَوِّي بَعْضُهَا بَعْضًا, where the messenger said, لَا طَلَاقَ وَلَا عِتَاقَ فِي إِغْلَاقٍ. That there's no divorce, and there's no freeing of the neck of a slave under coercion. Okay? Now let's go into the three types of the mawani'u al-taklif. The first one we said is jahl, right? Ignorance. And jahl we said is adamul ilmi, as the Shaykh brought it. Adamul ilmi is to have no knowledge. The ignorance, it comes in two forms. It comes in two forms. The first one is the person, the Shaykh mentioned it, rahimahullah, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen mentioned it, we're just taking it from his speech, is that the person is not heedless in learning. Some people are negligent. They don't want to learn. Just heedless, negligent, careless. The person here is not negligent. He's new to Islam. Or he was raised in a lifestyle. He was in Amazon forest, for example. Or is in a Bedouin lifestyle. He couldn't have got the ability to learn. He had no chance to learn. That individual has two situations. if he does something haram, such as he talks in the prayer, or a good news comes to him while he's in the middle of the prayer, and then he just drops into prostration, wants to do sujood shukri, okay? Or he does zina, or he steals, or he has sexual intercourse with his wife while she's on her menstruation, or he has sexual intercourse with his wife in the month of Ramadan. All of this based on ignorance. He's new to Islam, or he was raised في بادية بعيدة ولم يتمكنه التعلم. He couldn't learn. The Shaykh mentioned Ibn Uthaymeen, فلا شيء علي. There's nothing upon this person. When he means there's nothing upon him, what does he mean? فلا إثم علي. There's no sin on him. ولا قضاء علي. He doesn't have to bring it back. ولا كفارة. And there's no expiation upon this person. What's the evidence for that? The evidence for that is two. The first one is the hadith العربي الذي بالا في ناحية المسجد. The Bedouin man who urinated in the corner of the masjid. The messenger didn't punish him for that, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Hadith is found in Bukhari and Muslim. And also the second evidence is the hadith of Muawiyah ibn Hakam al-Sulami. Muawiyah ibn Hakam al-Sulami, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he spoke in the middle of the prayer. And the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he did not blame him, nor did he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, command him to bring back the prayer. Okay, and that's found in Sahih Muslim. The second situation is that he leaves off a wajib. He leaves off a wajib. This one, there's no sin on him. As for whether he has to bring it back or not, then it depends on whether the ibadah has gone, the time for it, or it still stands. If the time of the ibadah still stands, then he has to bring it back, even if it's as short as a rak'ah remaining for that time of the prayer. When I say a rak'ah left, it doesn't mean a rak'ah for the jama'ah. It means a rak'ah for the timing of the prayer to finish. Then he has to bring it back. If the time is gone, then he doesn't have to bring it back. He doesn't. And the evidence for that is the al-musi'u salatahu, the one who incorrectly prayed. The sahabi who incorrectly prayed, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't command him to bring it back. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't. And many of the companions, they misunderstood the ayah of the Allah Azza wa Jalla, Al-Khaytu al-Abyatu min al-Khaytu al-Aswadi min al-Fajr. They actually took two ropes, one black and one white, and they tied it on their leg, and they said that they waited for it to come out, the sun, until they can tell the white from the black. And that's going to be very bright. And so in other words, they were eating until past the time. They misunderstood the verse. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't command them to bring back the prayer. To bring back the fasting. Also, Ammar radiallahu ta'ala, Ammar ibn Yasir, when he tamarraga fi al-sa'idi, kama tamarraga al-dabba, when he was meant to do tayammum, right? But he didn't do the tayammum correctly. He scuffled on the earth like the riding beast does. The Prophet didn't return him to bring back the prayer. When the Ramadan was made obligatory on the second year of the Hijriyah, and the news didn't reach the people of Habasha, it didn't reach them. The Muslims that were in Abyssinia, the news didn't reach them. So the whole month left. Holy time month, he missed them. They didn't fast. The Messenger didn't command them to bring back that fasting. As for the man who was doing wudu, and then there was a portion of his leg where the water didn't touch. The water didn't touch. What did the Prophet command him to do? He commanded him to do the wudu again. The Prophet ﷺ commanded him to do the wudu again. Why? Because the time was still in. Because the time was still in. The second is al-nisyan. What does nisyan mean? Dhuhulul qalbi. Nisyan is dhuhulul qalbi an shay'in ma'lumin. That the person forgets something that they generally know. But they just forgot it. Something you knew is no longer in your heart now. You forgot it for a period of time. That's what nisyan means. It's to forget, basically. It comes in two ways. It comes in what? Two ways. Before I go into that one, I need to mention the second form of jahl. I only mentioned the first form of ignorance. The second form of ignorance is he is negligent in terms of learning. And he is able to learn, but he didn't do so. This one, he's going to be accounted for every haram that he's done. And he's also going to be accounted for every wajib which he left. And he has to bring it back. He has to bring it back, those ibadat that he missed. And he has to pay it back. Now we're going to go into the nisyan. We said nisyan means to forget something. It comes in two forms. أن يفعل شيئا محرما, and the person does something which is haram. كمن صلى وعليه نجاسة. A person prays and upon them is a najasa. The person is praying and there is upon them najasa. Or he speaks in the middle of the prayer out of forgetfulness. Or he eats in Ramadan out of forgetfulness. Or he places perfume, or he hunts or muhrim while he's in a state of ihram out of forgetfulness. فَلَا شَيْءَ عَلَيْهِ, there's nothing upon this person. Meaning, what do we mean by there's nothing upon him? There's no sin upon him. And there's no expiation that he needs to come with. And he doesn't have to pay back anything. He doesn't have to come back with that ibadah. The second form is أَيَتْرُكَ وَاجِبًا, he leaves off a wajib. Like he forgot Salatu al-Dhuhri until the time went. Or he forgot to give Sadaqatul Fitri until Salatul Eid came. There is no sin upon him. And he's not burdened whilst he's forgetting. While he's forgetting, there's nothing upon him. But when he remembers, he has to bring it back. Whenever he remembers, he has to bring it back. And the evidence for that is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ found in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim. مَنْ نَسْيَ صَلَاةً, anyone who forgets a prayer, فَلْيُصَلِّيهَا إِذَا ذَكَرَهَا, he has to pray when he remembers it. And other ibadat, all the other ibadat, we take a qiyas from this, an analogy from this. The third, which is al-ikrah. Al-ikrah is a person is coerced or is under duress. Coercion or duress. And it comes in two ways. The first one is, he is forced into doing something which is batil. This comes in two forms now. The first form, it comes in two ways, in two situations. He's made to do a haram thing. Like for example, he is being coerced. He's coerced into al kufri, disbelief. But his heart is tranquil upon iman. فَلَا شَيْءَ عَلَيْهِ, there's nothing upon this person. And the evidence for that is مَنْ كَفَرَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِ إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ أَمَا وَلَا تُكْرِهُ فَتَيَاتِكُمْ عَلَى الْبِغَاءِ إِنْ أَرَدْنَا تَحَصُّنًا لِتَبْتَغُوا عَرَضَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَنْ يُكْرِهُنَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِكْرَاهِنَّ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. The second form of the batil, when a person is forced under batil, is أَنْ يُكْرَهَ عَلَى تَرْكِ الْوَاجِبِ, he's told to leave off a wajib. Like he's told to leave salah. Or he's told to leave fasting until the time is gone. This person, there's nothing upon him, hal al-ikrah. The country has banned him from fasting. They said, you can't fast in Ramadan. We're going to kill you if you do it. So what does he do? He eats. Because he's under ikrah. But what does he have to do? He has to do qada, is to bring it back in another time. It's to bring it back in another time. And this is an issue that's outstanding in China, where some Muslims in China are not allowed to fast. So upon them is to what? Is to bring back the fasting another time. That's the first form. The second form is أن يكره بحق. He's coerced into doing something with حق. It's right. Like the governor and the leader of the Muslims, he coerces him على الطلاق. Divorce. Because this man did. He turned his back on his wife sexually when he was sexually. He said, I'm not going to come to you. And he was told to, you have 4 months. And after 4 months, he's still out to say no. Then he's divorced from her. Or any other legal reasons. That's ikrah, which is haq, and it will take place. The conditions that the scholars mentioned that have to be found in ikrah for it to be considered ikrah. A person cannot just easily say, this is coercion, and I wasn't able to do anything. There are three conditions. أَن يَكُونَ مِنْ قَادِرٍ عَلَى تَنْفِيذِ مَا هَدَّدَ بِهِ. The person who is threatening you is able to fulfill and go through with their threat. Okay. Second is أن يعلم المكره أو يغلب على ظنه نزول الوعيد به. The second one is the one who is being coerced into doing this. He has a high speculation that this threat is going to happen. The first one is able to do it, and the second one is that it is most likely going to happen. Its possibility is very high that it's going to happen. And number three is أن يتضرر به كثيرا إذا نزل به. A great harm is going to afflict him if it happens. Like for example, he's going to be killed, or he's going to be severely hit, or he's going to be in prison for too long. Those are the three conditions that the scholars mentioned. If you go to the 10th volume in Al-Mughni, Ibn Qudama mentions it. You can find it also in the Tahbir, which is Sharh al-Tahrir. You can find it in the sharh of Mukhtasar al-Rawda. And other fuqaha and usuleen mention it. We finish with Lillahi alhamdu wal minna, the nahi. We're going to start inshaAllah ta'ala the general statement inshaAllah ta'ala tomorrow's lesson. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.